Greetings to you all in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. I thank and praise God for giving me this privilege once again to share God's word in Peniel. Thank the elders and the members of the church for all your prayers. The Lord has been good to us during the 7 to 8 months of this pandemic. And the fangs of this deadly COVID-19 has been taking tolls of life, causing so much of immeasurable pain and distress in the world. The church universal and the church in India has been hit hard, and the faith of the Christians has been tested at all points. Gathering together for worship and fellowship has been also been challenged. But thank God for the media and the technology that He has given to us, that we can be in fellowship with one another through this technology that He has given. We as God's people have been kept by His power and sustained through these hardships, hard days. The Lord has kept our faith alive and helping us to grow in spiritual life as families and as a church. Despite the global pandemic, the Church and Mission Organization India are making the best use of the social media in keeping the gospel still spreading and the mission's objectives being fulfilled. Our homes have become many churches, and prayers and worship has become much more realistic and linking us with one another through the Holy Spirit and His Word. At a time like this, the Lord has provided us as individuals and this church precious word to be strengthened, and by the power of the Holy Spirit to move forward, to stand firm in our faith and march forward. I've been studying and meditating on the life and ministry of Elijah the prophet of old. In the midst of the most challenging situations, from 1 Kings chapter 17, 18 and 19. So before we go further, may we pause for a just word of prayer that God's Holy Spirit will minister to us. Shall we pray? Gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this privilege of fellowship together as a church. We worship you, we praise you, we thank you for all your faithfulness and your goodness during these very tough days. And you have carried us through and helped us to rejoice in you, in the salvation that you have given, and in the fellowship of saints, that we can be kept, Lord, strong in you through thy word and through the power of your Holy Spirit. Be with us as we meditate on this aspect of life of Elijah, and strengthen us through the experiences of this great prophet. Holy Spirit of God, minister to me and minister to us at this time. In Jesus' precious and mighty name we pray. Amen. A few lessons from the prophet Elijah as we journey through the present challenging days. Elijah was one of the great prophets in Israel, and he was challenging even the whole community of Judah and Israel and the kings who were not able to rule with the dignity and with the power of God. The Elijah's name means Yahweh is my God. Only 6 chapters of the Old Testament record Elijah's life and ministry, and we see in 6 major incidents told through these chapters Yep. Elijah was a prophet of courage and faithfulness. We see that this is, he is one of those who did not die. Like Enoch, Enoch was walking with God and he was taken by God. And Elijah did serve the Lord and he was taken into heaven in a chariot of fire. And we see that he appeared to, we know from the scriptures that he appeared to Jesus at the Mount of Transfiguration along with Moses, and they saw the glory of the Lord on that mount. Elijah, during his short term of these six incidents and these six chapters, has done a great ministry for the people and for the Lord. And in this little map that we can see how much a man of God, a prophet of God, could achieve in a very short time. And if you journey through him, Elijah, you see he started from Tishba, then he goes on to Carmel, then he goes to Samaria, he goes to Paran, and then he goes to Mount Horeb, and he goes back again, and from the last stage he is taken off to heaven. We'll see one or two definite incidents and also learn from him. This little song, which have been very familiar to all of us, tell us of what is happening today. These are the days of Elijah declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these days are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sorrow, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. We, as we go through this pandemic and face all the trials and difficulties, you can say that we are also passing through such difficult days as Elijah went through. And from his life, we can learn how we can maneuver, how we can get ourselves steady at this trying stage and do the work of the Lord without any hindrance. The days of Elijah, when we compare, when Israel reached unprecedented level of evil and wickedness, because King Ahab of Israel was one of the most wicked kings who started idol worship, and they went away from the Lord. But God sent his servant to challenge the king and ask the people of God to return to him. And as you reflect the present condition of the world, as Paul says, 2 Timothy 3, 1-4, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. If only you read through the newspapers and watch the news every day on the media, you can see the whole thing that we read together in 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1-4, how people have gone away from the Lord, not only in India, but all over the world. They have become lovers of themselves, or we have become lovers of ourselves instead of lovers of God. In that situation, God wanted to speak to Elijah, prepare him for all that is ahead of him. And in 1 Kings chapter 17, 2 to 5, the word of the Lord came to Elijah, "Leave here, turn eastward and hide in Kerith Ravin, east of the Jordan. You will drink from the brook, and I have directed the ravens to supply you with food there." What a great challenge for Elijah. There was no rain. There was no harvest. And God asked him to go to Kerith Ravin. But the great prophet, he obeyed. So he did what the Lord has told him. He went to Kerith Ravin, east of Jordan, and stayed there. As Elijah was directed, he never questioned God. His implicit obedience to God and trust in God is a challenge to us these days. When things go against our own planning and the things in the world are turning otherwise, whatever our circumstance, we can trust God according to Philippians 4:19, and he will provide. As Paul says, "My God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." The Lord provided meat and bread to Elijah through the ravens, a very rare, unique way of supply to a prophet by God's provision. And then the brook dried. Elijah went obeying the Lord. The Lord provided for him. And when the brook dried, God made another provision. He graciously directed Elijah to the home of a widow in Zarephath. When God closes a door, he always opens another. In Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9, the Lord says, "My ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts." During this pandemic period, we have also seen that many of the things were unexpected. Lockdowns and situations which we cannot imagine have been before us, but the Lord fulfilled his thoughts, and he is ready to open the doors for us. And the Lord is encouraging us to trust him, and there is need for us to trust to provide through any source that God will have for us. Trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And then when the Lord provided a place for him through a widow's generosity, he was looked after, and the widow's son dies. In 1 Kings 17, 20 to 22, we read that incidents of the young boy dying and the woman widow coming and crying to the prophet, "Why did you allow this to happen?" And that was a hard thing for Elijah. So he took it to the Lord in prayer. He said, he entreated the Lord. He said, "Lord, that this lady, this woman has provided me with all this at this time of my need. Why did you bring me here? Why did you allow this boy to die?" So he entreated the Lord, prayed, and the fervent prayer of Elijah, the soul of the child came back to him, and he revived. And when things go beyond our capacity, beyond our control, we learn from Elijah that we need to find a time and place to pour out our hearts to God in prayer. This may be one situation, but as we pray, as we see many situations that which are beyond our control during this time and in our own lives, God reminds us from James chapter 5, verse 16 and 17, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land 3 and a half years. Again, he prayed and the heavens gave rain and earth produced its crops. The God they worshipped, Baal, was a God of rain and God of harvest. And both were blocked, and people were not knowing what to do. And the same is the role of the church today. E.M. Bounds says what the church needs today is not missionary or better, not new organizations or more novel methods, but men and women whom the Holy Spirit can use, people mighty in prayer. The fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Because we have all been praying and interceding for healing of nations, healing for people who are hit by this COVID-19, and for comfort of people who have lost their dear ones. And in the midst of this, there is persecution of the church. The many of the evangelists and pastors are left without any support. And there is an urgent need of prayer for the church universal, persecuted missionaries in India and many parts of the world, and healing of our nations, healing from all the hatred and jealousy and enmity, and also healing from the effects of COVID-19. Elijah meets a very helpful man, Obadiah. He was a devout believer in the Lord. And he says, from my young days, I've been following and trusting the Lord. Elijah had a mission, but God gave him a supporter. While Jezebel was killing the Lord's prophets, what Elijah could not do, Obadiah did. Obadiah has taken 100 prophets, hid them in 2 caves, supplied them with food and water. We see that he risked his life, obeyed God and obeyed Elijah, was zealous for God's people. And also when Elijah said, you go and tell Ahab that I am here, first he was hesitant, but he went later on and informed the king that Elijah was back in the land. Have we have taken any risk and done something for Jesus during these lockdown days? Have we been able to support someone as they went through crisis, prayed for someone who lost their dear ones? As he saw around, he saw the people faltering between 2 opinions. They wanted to follow God and also worship Baal. But Elijah had to call them to do the right thing and worship the Lord God Jehovah only. So Elijah went before, as you read in 1 Kings 18:21, Elijah went before the people and said, how long will you waver between 2 opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. The people of Elijah's days were procrastinators, and therefore Elijah had to confront them. But the response was very cold. But the people said nothing. He said again that if you want to follow the Lord, you have to reject Baal and follow the Lord with the fullness of heart. And many times in our lives, God wants us to make decisions on some of the issues in our spiritual lives. What is more dear to us, probably we hold on. And in obeying the Lord, we procrastinate. And those who have not yielded their lives yet to the Lord Jesus, still following in your own ways, the Lord is calling. I am your Savior. I am your Lord who died for you. Follow me and I will take charge of your life. Now maybe this is the time when a time for commitment for those who do not know the Lord. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. So may this be the beginning of a new life for some, and also for us when we have left things undone, to make new decisions for in our spiritual life. So you see, in Elijah at Mount Carmel, he proved it, a showdown with the false prophets. Then when he had put the altar and offered the sacrifice, the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stone, the soil, and also licked up the water in trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." Now, this is why the prophet was kept there during the days of Ahab. Though Ahab and Jezebel were taking people away from God, Elijah was there to prove that Jehovah was their true God and they have to return to him. In a showdown with the false prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel, he proved to Ahab that only the Lord is God. And after that, he removed the evil from the midst of the people. Elijah then killed the prophets. Well, great victories bring sometimes great challenges after that. When we relax after the victory and don't keep in touch with the faithfulness of God, fear can cause us to stumble. Fear caused Elijah to compromise his testimony. He took to heart the words of Queen Jezebel, who said, "Whatever you have done to the prophets of Baal, I will do to you. Your life will be taken." And so he was scared, but forgot the promises and victory of the Lord that he gave him. What we learn from Elijah at this time is fear and unbelief can rob us of the power and the joy. The Lord is asking me and asking us to beware. In 1 John 5:4, faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Opposite of unbelief is faith. Faith in the Lord, faith in His faithfulness, and faith in the power of the Holy Spirit. As it says in 2 Timothy 1:7, God has not given to us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Lord, during these days, we need this more. Help us to experience the power of the Holy Spirit as we pass through these difficult days. And as people are suffering, we may be able to support them. We may be able to tell them of the love of Jesus and the provision of God and the love of yours with those who need it. A time came and Elijah said, "Lord, it is enough now, Lord." Elijah asked God to take his life. He was exhausted physically and emotionally, And so he felt that his life is at risk, and he asked God to take his life. Not only just Elijah, there are others who prayed like this. Moses prayed when people of God rebelled, people of God sinned, and forgot the great works of God. Moses said, Lord, take away my life. Job said that in his suffering. Jonah said when he was running away, and when he was asked to preach to Nineveh, he sat down and then wanted to avoid what the mission that God has given and said, take away my life. But God had different plans for these great men of God, and God has plans for Elijah, because the prophet's greatest success was still ahead of him. He had to anoint the king of Syria, he had to anoint the king of Israel, and he has to train Elisha as his successor. And instead of going to complete the mission, he became blind to this great call of God and wanted a shorter way to go to him. But God's chariot of fire did not come at that time. The chariot of fire came only after he finished the last job of establishing Elisha as his successor. We need to give ourselves completely to the Lord. The Lord has been speaking to me at this time, and whatever I'm holding, very precious. And whatever I'm thinking at this time to make my life short and go to the Lord immediately. The Lord says, my time is not yet come. You have a great job to be done. You are yet to complete your mission. And as we pray that he will give us grace to finish the task entrusted to us, maybe we can ask him, Lord, what do you want me to do during this pandemic? What are the jobs that you want me to complete? And Elijah went to one place and he entered into a cave, and he was there, again thinking of the failures and telling, I am the only one who is left alone. There is nobody else. God confronted his servant who is called to carry on his mission. And he said, Elijah, what are you doing here? And maybe God is challenging me and us today in these days of danger and changing situation. So what we are doing for him. And he was challenged by reading Mark 1, 13, 14. I will read it. And Jesus was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered unto him. What an experience. Now after that, John was put in prison. Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Very trying situation. The Savior came after the temptation. Angels ministered to him, and he heard that John was put in prison. But that didn't stop our Savior to do what the Father sent him to do. Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. There's a challenge that comes to us this time, whatever may be the hardships around. The evangelistic work of the church must go on. Individual, person to person, personal evangelism and church mission must be completed. We can find new methods, how we can reach out to people with all the social media which is available with us. We can ask the Lord to reach out to somebody each day. Lord, give me one person to whom I can share your gospel. help us as a church to reach out to some group somehow. And these 9 months we have crossed, and help us to complete the mission that you've given to us in spite of the hardships. Mentoring young people, the young people who need direction, who have lost their identity, who are struggling through their university or college or school education. They need our mentoring, they need our support. Lord, tell me, teach me how I can, by new methods or new ways that I can reach out to them and build them up as your disciples. Finally, the Lord says, beware when you think you are alone. Because always Elijah was telling, I'm the only one left. They are seeking my life. But beware when we think we are alone. The Lord said to Joshua, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. The Lord Jesus' last command was, in his great commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples and teach them whatever I have taught you. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Lord, we thank you that you are not left us alone, and you will be with us as we journey through and as we long to complete the mission that you have given to us. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me alone. No final reflections in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8 and 9. 2 Corinthians 4, 8 and 9. I'd like to read this. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 8 to 9. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. And verse 8, 17 and 18. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So as we are encouraged by these words, though we are troubled on every side, we have a Savior to support us. We are not distressed. We are not in despair. He is there to save us. He is there to carry us through. In the life of Elijah, his confidence increased only when, by living an intimate relationship with God, he could relate to God in such a way in every situation. We have to reject the thought, I am alone. The devil will bring many times the self-pity and say, I'm the only one in the office, I'm the only one in my establishment, and I'm the only one in my family who is very true to the Lord. And the Lord reminds us, reminded Elijah, there are 7,000 people who have not bowed their knees to Baal. Lord, I am not alone. My church is with me. Many of God's children are supporting me. And thy Holy Spirit is there to strengthen me. Your word is there to encourage me. So we need to reject the thought, I am alone and left without any support. And one of the reasons what Elijah did was to hear the small voice of God. He heard the thunder in that experience. He heard the earthquake, but the Lord was not in it. But he spoke to him in the final stage, the still small voice. Learning to wait on the Lord is what is needed during these days. Listen to the wait on the Lord and listen to what he says to us in our spiritual walk, where how closely I can draw to him, draw near to God and God will draw nigh to you, is what James says. Lord, help me to draw near to you every day. Even when we feel fear and failure, God will empower us to complete his work when we trust and obey. 1 Peter 5 verse 10, the Lord assures us as we close this session, and the Lord God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm and steadfast. The Lord has got a job for us, which is still to be completed. Lord, help us to press on and look to you and run the race and complete the mission that you have given to us as individuals, as families, and as a church. In closing, I'd like to read these words from what Jude, who encourages us this way. But ye beloved, build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy. Lord, help us to build on our most holy faith which you have given in the Holy, and pray in the Holy Ghost as we journey through each day of our life. Keep us victorious and keep us rejoicing in you. May the Lord help these few thoughts and carry us through the days ahead for his glory. Shall we pray? Gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we pray that all that you have taught us from the life of Elijah will encourage us in our walk with you and in our journey through our life during these difficult days. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the living word that you have given to us. Help us each day to listen to your still small voice and obey you and complete the mission that you have given to us. Bless everyone, members of Peniel, and watch over each one, Lord, and grant us your victory. Those who are in the medical line, Lord, in the front line serving the community, I pray that you will grant them your wisdom, your skill, and your grace, and reward them for all that they have done and are doing for you. The students scattered all over in different parts of this land, not able to come to the university or college, Lord, be with them and let them not feel that they are alone, but that you are with them to give them the fruitful life. Be with each family and in all our needs, Lord. Be thou our all-sufficient God. Philippians 4:19 will be our true experience. My God shall supply all your needs according to riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Bless the mission of the church. Bless every effort and bless the elders of the church, the little children, the young people, and the senior citizens. Everyone will be blessed by you. Make this word to come alive to us and keep us, Lord, victorious and rejoicing in you. For we pray this prayer with thanksgiving in Jesus' precious and mighty name. Amen.